Please arrange for the deputations to come in and be seated.
多謝各位。
Thank you. This is the fourth session of today's public hearing, and it's the last session. We have 28 deputations and individuals.
Let me remind those present, if you have any placard standing in front of you that is standing too high up, your face will be blocked. Without further ado, we will start. Thank you, deputations, residents, association, and individuals for attending this panel meeting. And thank you for supplying information to us. Let me remind you all that what you say is not protected under the Legislative Council Powers and Privileges Ordinance. In each deputation, we have 3 minutes. And I need to apologize that 3 minutes is not enough to say everything you have in mind, but there are numerous deputations and there is not enough time, so we'll have to be limited to 3 minutes. This is a timer. When your time is up, you will hear a bell and you will have to stop. We have simultaneous interpretation service. You see this earpiece, channel 1 is Cantonese, channel 0 is the floor, and channel 2 is English. And this microphone is very sensitive, so there is no need to be too close to the microphone, otherwise it would be difficult.
Hearing conducted by the Environmental Affairs Panel, that please be reminded that your speech would not be protected by the Power and Privilege Ordinance for the Legislative Council. And I also apologize that each representative's speech time is limited to 3 minutes, which is definitely inadequate for you to express yourself fully, but because there are a lot of members from the public that wish to express their opinion, therefore, unfortunately, we have to limit the time for everybody to 3 minutes. And the timer here would show the length of your speech, and when 3 minutes is up, you would hear the signal to give you a gentle reminder. 好了，我哋第一位。
The first one, Mr. Edmund Dare. Thank you.
I'd like to take the opportunity to respond what the Secretary said. He said that residents of Changguanuo is emotional. Well, actually, we come here to engage in a rational discussion. We would like to make our stance clear to the Secretary. The administration in the past rolled out a number of measures proposed to be implemented after the extension of the landfill, but they target residents along Wanpo Road and Lohas Park. But this is a problem for Changguanuo as a whole, not just something affecting Lohas Park and those along Wanpo Road. The odor is overwhelming and it spreads to different areas, Hang Hao Po Lam, Tiu King Lang. And I don't see measures mentioned by the Secretary apply to other areas to help residents. The second point, if the landfill is to be extended and expanded, we're worried about the conveyance of waste. In 2020, Changguanuo South Tunnel will be commissioned. The material for the fill bank will not just go through Wanpo Road, it will go to the link and also the tunnel affecting residents in Tiu King Lane, Changguanuo, but I don't see any measures addressing our concern. Number three, this will also affect transport. We know, as far as we know, there is a noise problem and traffic congestions in Changguanuo Tunnel. If you add more refuse collection vehicles to the load, it will only deteriorate. So I urge the administration and the secretary to carefully consider whether the landfill should be expanded. And if the secretary has time, I ask him to come to Changguanuo, to Wanpo Road, to get a better understanding about the older problem. Today's hot. And I believe that a lot of residents from Lohas Park and Changguanuo will be in the center of this problem. Thank you. Mr. Michael Tong and Mr. Cheung Chi Tong, may I stand up? No, you may not, because similar requests were made and they were disallowed. Thank you. Thank you. Secretary, you see, today I have a bald head, which is bolder than yours. Our district councillor said that talked about having his head shaved in objection to the extension, but he didn't do it, so I did it. Apart from odour, there are many other problems coming from the landfill, bugs. It affects us, affects the quality of our lives. I've met with you before and I've expressed the same to you. There are other problems apart from odour, traffic volume, noise, air pollution, affecting the surrounding areas as well. Well, whether it is an industrial area or an area for rubbish, it's the same. So I have my head shaved today to tell you that there is a problem with the integrity of the administration. We live in a place, we hope for a good life, but with an extension or expansion of the landfill, how do you expect us to live? The secretary said that there are experts here who have spoken in a rational way. I can tell you that these experts have not lived in this place to enjoy the environment. You don't have to buy a place. I have one there. You're most welcome to live there. It's over 1,000 square feet It's got a very good view of the landfill. There is also the odor problem. You can enjoy these things every day. But what about the residents? They bought the place. Can they just move anytime they want? It is a lifetime aspiration for people to buy a flat. What do they get in return? We live near a landfill. Canada, America, friends called me and asked me if there are problems with the landfill. And I asked them how they knew. They said it's all over the news. Well, Secretary, you talk about being rational. Can you do the same for us? Ask legislators to support us, to oppose to the expansion of the landfill. Yes, ours is the smallest out of the three. But we're talking about something that we face day after day. It's been 4 years. Edward Yao told me that the landfill will be closed very soon, and that's why I made the purchase. But we've fallen into the pit. We live near a landfill, and we can only complain about the odor problem.
Mr. Luke, thank you, Madam Chairman. This year is 2013. In 1998, when I moved into the town centre of Chang Kwan Lo, I got the message that the landfill would be closed in 2013. That was the plan. That's why I moved in. But the government breached our trust. They deceived us into moving into this area, and then they even proposed to expand the landfill. And they told the public that if we do not have a landfill, then where are we going to dispose of the waste? Has the government considered, several years ago, you promised that you would close down the Chang Kwan Lo landfill in 2013, and you already had planned at the time as to how to dispose of the waste then. And today you tell us that, yes, maybe Hong Kong people will believe you, but for the Chang Kwan Lo residents, they will say you lied to them. At present, in Wan Po Road, the design is not to cater for that many number of refuse collection vehicles and dump trucks. Now, even after taking into account domestic waste reduction, those vehicles which are transporting these wastes as well as construction waste, they generated a lot of dusts over PM2.5 and even to PM10. This is actually causing people early deaths. If you can, Secretary, please come to our center, town center, and breathe in our air. I'm sure if you live there for 10 years, you will have an early death. Our people in Chang Kwan Lo are rational. When we sit here and discuss this with you, we are rational. You mentioned something about the Cheung Lam tunnel, and you said that that tunnel was to be built in 2010. This year is 2013, and now we got the message that it would be built in 2016, and we have grave misgivings as to whether that is indeed going to be the case. You asked the Cheung Kwan Lo residents to be more accommodating. Why don't you not be accommodating on us? Why can't you close the landfill now, if Chang Kwan Lo residents tell you no? We are going to tell you no. So in dealing with the process of handling domestic waste, in your predecessor, Mr. Yao, imposed the environmental levy on plastic bags. That is a good measure. But why wasn't that measure taken earlier? And why was no measure taken about waste treatment? Yes. Just now, you said that Chang Kwan Lo residents were emotional in discussing this matter. I would welcome you to Hang Hao roundabout to have an afternoon tea with you. Then you'll realize what sort of difficult situations we're in. It's not that only people living in Lo House Park will smell the bad odor. In fact, when there are different wind directions, people in other parts of Chang Kwan Lo will also be affected. And noise is also another problem. At present, in Chang Kwan Lo, there are 80,000 vehicles going to Chang Kwan Lo every day. and there are 3,700 refuse collection vehicles and dumper trucks going in and out of Changguanou Tunnel. And for those living nearby the tunnels, they are suffering from noise nuisance. Some are also living close to the highways. Apart from noise nuisance, there's also dust emission. A lot of people there, as well as political groups, have already asked why no noise barriers were erected so as to minimize the impact on the residents. The government told us that the landfills are almost exhausted and you have to expand them. When I first studied in Changguanou area, I also learned that the Changguanou landfill would be closed soon, but I'm already in university now and the landfill has not yet been closed. People in Changguanou actually have a very difficult time. You said we were emotional, in fact, we were very rational. And in the document, you mentioned waste reduction at source, and you said that you will achieve 40% reduction. But if you cannot achieve that, and you ask people to tolerate a little bit longer, there is no long-term policy in the document to address the issue of waste reduction. If you expand the landfill time and again, and if we have to wait for another 10 years, how can we believe you? There's no long-term policy for waste reduction, so as to allay the concern of people in Changguanou that one day they will see the closure of the Changguanou landfill. You mentioned that in Changguanou landfill, you're not going to put in municipal solid waste, and there will not be bad odor. But a lot of the dump trucks, in fact, would cause a more nuisance. For example, fly tipping, dust emission, traffic congestion. This will cause even worse situation in Changguanou. Although I cannot stand to make my speech, in the past, in Sai Kung District Council, as well as Changguanou District Council, they have opposed the expansion of landfill. I'll urge you to oppose the plan. Mr. Chen, I think at present the more pressing issue for the government is not to expand the landfill. Rather, it is to come up with an in-situ waste recycling policy. There are two reasons for me to oppose the landfills. First, I share the view of the speaker before me. That is, I think the government has not done enough in terms of waste reduction. For example, Environmental Park. Last year, it was mentioned that there will be 50,000 tons, but altogether it will only mean 14,000 tons. So in terms of target, you have only achieved 50% of what you targeted to achieve. And you have also misled the public. The first organic waste treatment facility had only been built 2 years later. There are also a major problem with the assumptions that you put in your action blueprint. Recycled waste is supposed to be exportable, but what we are facing now is that in 2011, the mainland government has taken a more stringent control over solid waste. And there is a reduction of 730,000 tons of rubber waste exported. I think some of this waste might have found their way to the landfills, and as a result, it caused the landfill to fill up more easily. At present, 50% of our waste was exported. If these 9,000 tons of waste every day is to be kept in Hong Kong, then it will need another 3 to 4 instant landfills. So I think if there is this stringent policy in the mainland, then it will cause disruption to your assumptions. I think you have to encourage recycling business in Hong Kong in order to address the issue of waste reduction. The government should sponsor the establishment of more waste recycling business, such as waste paper recycling business. In terms of reduction of construction waste, on the 14th of January this year, I in fact came up with a proposal. According to Mr. Leung's policy, when a policy becomes mature, it should be implemented. But so far, there is no implementation of this policy. Thank you. Mr. Liu? Well, I think all of you have already sat here for hours today. Over the years, the government has not come up with a concrete policy to deal with waste. It seems like we're sweeping the refuse under the carpet, and if there are more waste, then we will buy another carpet. Now we're talking about expanding three landfills. I would like to ask the Secretary, after these expansion schemes, where are we going to find another landfill? The government has indicated that there were a lot of policies to encourage waste recycling, for example, bottles, food waste, and plastic bags. In these three areas, the government has not made an effort to control their waste. As a result, there will be more use of the landfills, for example, bottles, glass bottles. The government could have encouraged the use of broken glass bottles to be converted into tiles so that they can be used for construction. But when these materials are included in the bricks, then they can no longer be extracted. And if these bricks were later on removed, then they would end up in the landfills as well. There is no policy to convert these bricks back to raw materials. That is, part of it could become glass again so that they can be reused. I think this is what should have been done. Plastic over-packaging. Now, some people say that there should be a levy on excessive packaging. Now, of course, people in Hong Kong are very clever. They know that the cost will be passed on to consumers. The government does not seem to have considered this. For example, if a company has carried out excessive packaging, you could prevent these companies from launching their products so that you can reduce waste at source. Finally, on food waste, perhaps it was only done in the last 1 to 2 years. Usually, it was done at a domestic level. For example, spending $1,000 or so to buy a tuck to contain these wastes. Have you considered in your long-term policy, you would consider having some collection center in a housing estate? For example, setting aside a space such as a refuse collection room so that there could be in situ waste recycling. When waste recycling can be done in situ, it will help reduce the burden of landfills and incinerators. The government is asking the government to give them money to expand the landfills. We talk about social responsibilities. We talk about asking companies to do a little bit more. It seems like the government has not taken on any social responsibility. Thank you, Madam Chairman. The Hong Kong Institution of Engineers is very concerned about the increasing number of waste. In order to deal with this problem, we support the Action Blueprint and the policies set out in the Action Blueprint and the target dates. The Hong Kong IE views that there should be a holistic approach to waste management and reuse and recycle should be the main focus so as to deal with the special circumstances in Hong Kong and the increasing number of or increasing volume of waste in Hong Kong. We understand that no matter how hard we try to control and reduce waste, we cannot dispose of them altogether. For example, construction waste, industrial waste, as well as non-recyclables. Therefore, using landfills to deal with these wastes is indispensable. However, we should keep it to a minimal and should only be considered as a last resort. The Hong Kong IE accepts the expansion plan for existing landfills, but they should do it within a reasonable time frame. We suggest that when the government came up with the landfill contracts for the three landfills, you should require the contractor to implement a landfill gas utilization and export scheme. And we suggest the government to ensure that the government should explain clearly to all stakeholders so as to garner enough support from the community. The government should also set up a liaison committee for all stakeholders so as to collect views from different stakeholders. In order to gain support from the community, we believe the government should clearly set down in the proposed environmental monitoring and audit programs and to allow the stakeholders to monitor the implementation of these projects. The Hong Kong RE would also suggest that the government should give real-time information to the public so as to enhance the transparency of the environmental impact assessment study and to allow the public to understand better the recommendations in these EIA. The Hong Kong RE would be pleased to offer assistance and professional input so as to help the government address the waste issue.
Madam Chairman, we urge the Honourable Members to consider two deeply shocking statistics hidden in the Environment Bureau's Blueprint for Sustainable Use of Resources and to draw the obvious conclusions about glaring anomalies and a waste management strategy that is completely at odds with the facts. From the footnotes on pages 18 and 4 of the blueprint, it is easy to calculate that only 7% of MSW generated on a daily basis is actually being recovered. Why then does EPD claim on page 10 that 48% of MSW is recycled? We can only conclude that either EPD officials are innumerate or that Hong Kong's true rate of waste generation is far higher than stated. The second shocking statistic appears in a pie chart on page 4, showing the breakdown of MSW into a number of categories. A staggering 44% is food waste, and this means that 4,000 tons of organic waste is going to landfill every day. The other significant categories are paper, 22%, and plastics, 19%. So a total of 85% of our MSW comes from these three categories alone. This tells us that EPD's strategy is totally misdirected. A concerted assault on the food waste scandal, plus a credible attempt to separate paper and plastic from household waste territory-wide, could solve the MSW disposal problem at a stroke, cancelling the need for unpopular landfill extensions and the costly and environment-damaging incinerator. EPD's reduce, recycle and reuse strategies therefore lack any real conviction. The food waste issue is absolutely critical and is a moral and economic imperative, yet EPD only targets 500 tonnes to be reprocessed by 2022, a mere 13% of total organic waste. And only $50 million is allocated from the ECF to food waste recycling projects. There are no specific targets for recycling paper and plastics, and apparently no budget increase. Many people in Hong Kong, particularly the citizens of New Territories and Islands District, are demoralised by the prospect of having their quality of life significantly impaired by the EPD's outdated project engineering approach to what is essentially a process management issue. It is the EPD more than the citizens of Hong Kong that needs a mindset change. If at this early stage they are allowed to take the easy option of spending large capital sums on landfill extensions and mass burn incineration, we can be sure that Hong Kong will never get a modern waste management system.
Thank you. Oh, Yu Lam, 先生.
Yes, while I am here to represent the Democratic Party, I'm not going to repeat what I already said. I would like to take the opportunity, since we have our honourable members, district councillors, as well as Chang Kwan residents in this conference room, I would like to take the opportunity to clarify some issues with the Secretary. First, I have been a district councillor for 8 years, from 2004 to 2011. According to my records, a few days ago, on the 27th of May, in a paper submitted by the Environmental Bureau to the environmental panel, you gave them a document relating to a meeting of the Sai Kung District Council on the 3rd of May. This is about the odor control measure in Southeast North New Territories landfill. In fact, at that time, the Sai Kung District Council did not vote on this matter because the chairman said there was no need. And a few days ago, in the paper that you submitted to the environmental panel, the Environmental Bureau said that the Sai Kung District Council said the District Council either agreed or do not oppose. In fact, at that time, we did not vote on this matter. We did not indicate whether we agreed or we did not object to it. So I think this is quite sneaky. This did not reflect what happened. You are twisting what the district councillors said at the time. And second, in the action blueprint, it was mentioned that the Chiang Kwan O landfill would not accept domestic waste, but it will still accept construction waste. At present, there are, in terms of vehicles carrying construction waste, the number is about double that of the vehicles carrying domestic waste. You pay no attention to the impact of particulates on the health of people. And as far as I know, there is no deadline for the closure of these landfills. It seems like it will go forever. I would like the Secretary to explain whether this is going to be the case. The government also said that it has not addressed the problem of noise and odor problem in Lohas Park. And there was also incident of fly tipping by trucks going along the Wan Po Road. As a result, people in Chiang Kwan O have been suffering from problems arising from the landfills. I wonder if the Environmental Bureau can come up with concrete measures to address these problems. If not, then why do you have to ask the Chiang Kwan O residents to support the expansion of the landfill? Professor Ho, thank you. I'm a scientist. I would like to analyze this problem from a scientific point of view. From a waste management point of view, zero waste is only an ideal and is something that cannot be achieved. So to say that this can be achieved is unscientific. So on the issue of expansion of landfill and opposing the establishment of more landfills, in fact, all we need to do is to try to strike a middle ground. And this indirectly shows that a zero landfill is also something that cannot be achieved, and in no places in around the world can that be achieved.
So for waste management, we need a basket of measures to address the problems. We need all the three R's, and not a single R enjoys priority. A landfill is a historical problem. It takes time to resolve this problem. Many deputations said that the secretary has not honored his word, and the landfills are not closed in time. Well, it is because we failed to build incinerators in the past years, and also people are objecting to waste charging, so that's why we still need these landfills. So for the future, I think we should be pragmatic. We shouldn't adopt a lopsided stance. So we need a clear waste reduction initiative so that landfills can be reduced. And also we need a clear timetable for doing these. And also we need a good
management system, we also need a correct mindset. Technically, Chang Kwan Oh landfill, when we look at the Environment Bureau's plan, it will be extended. However, I think we should negotiate that extent of extension, because there will be settlement and degradation in the landfill. The old waste will be compressed. So do we really need such a huge area for extension, as suggested by the Education Bureau? Maybe that's negotiable. And I think we should speed up the whole process of waste management so that we can address the concerns of the residents. Thank you. Mr. Wong? Well, for the newly announced blueprints, the government is suggesting that the landfills be extended. We regret this. Now, I would like to make 2 points. We object to the extension of the Chang Kwan Oh landfills. In the past 20 years, the Chang Kwan Oh residents have been suffering from these landfills. And up to now, about 3,000 to 4,000 WSMs are transported to Chang Kwan Oh landfill every day. And the Chang Kwan Oh residents hope that the landfill can be closed in 1 or 2 years' time. But when we look at the government's suggestion, it actually turns a deaf ear to the residents' objection. Now, we have to attach importance to the health of the residents there, and I think their daily lives are really affected. So you are asking them to suffer longer. This is totally unreasonable. And also for suspended particulates, they are related to respiratory diseases. And there are many dump trucks going in and out of Chang Kwan Oh, and when they dump the refills, dust will be flying, and this will actually create more suspended particulates, and this is harmful to human health. And Lohas Park is just several hundred meters away from the landfill, so their health is really at stake. We think that there should be a sustainable waste management policy, and we should start at source. The SAR government should implement a producer's responsibility scheme and waste charging scheme as early as possible. By doing so, people can be encouraged to reduce waste, and the Labour Department, well, the Labour Party also hopes that such kind of fees can be waived for the grassroots, because it will be significant for them. And they do not generate a lot of rubbish anyway. And for our producer responsibility scheme, we hope that the scheme can be enhanced and electrical appliances, etc., can be included in the scheme so as to reduce waste. For the blueprints, it is suggested that the recycling rate in 2022 be increased to 55%. Now, if we look at Germany, the landfill rate is only 1%. Hong Kong is an international city. We actually have the ability and resources to do better. The Labour Party hopes that the SAR government can increase the recycling rate to 73%. As for landfill rates, it should be reduced to 5% or lower. Thank you.
Madam Chang Wen-Kok.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm also a resident of Lohas Park, and I hope members can vote down Mr. Wong Kam Sing's proposal. Now, the Chang Kwan Oh landfill is already a nuisance, and the odor is intolerable. I have been living there for 3 years, and I have been calling the complaint hotline many times. And from this morning until now, I have been listening to people's views. And I don't think Mr. Wong and his team can solve these problems. And now you are extending the landfill. I am sure that you cannot resolve all those problems. Members asked a question this morning. They said that, well, there is this traffic air pollution and odor problem in Chang Kwan Oh. So if all these problems are resolved, would Chuan Kwan Lo residents accept the extension of the landfill? Well, no, because I don't think the secretary is shouldering his responsibility. He lies all the time. He always say that the whole city will be besieged by rubbish. Chuan Kwan Lo residents have been suffering for the past 20 years. We have been surrounded by rubbish for the past 20 years. Now, it's just convenient for you to dump all the rubbish at Chuan Kwan Lo. This is totally irresponsible on the part of the government. And as Secretary for Environment, Mr. Wong, I think you and your team should shoulder the responsibility. Maybe you should dump the rubbish in your own home. This morning, Mr. Wong said, there is the difference between expectation and promise. So after you assumed your post, did you promise us anything, or do you think we are just expecting things to happen? So for the Chuan Kwan Lo landfill problems, I think you should promise us improvements. Please do not give us any more 10-year timetable. I think you just want to be in your post for another term. That's why you give us this 10-year timetable. Madam Chair, I cannot speak Cantonese properly. Please let me speak in Putonghua. Now, for this environmental issue, the Secretary has made reference to a number of figures from overseas countries, but he did not mention one figure. What is that? That is for landfill and the distance, the standard distance between a landfill and a residential area. Is there a well standard? Would it be like Chuan Kwan Lo is just several hundred meters away? Is that the case? Now, is this the minimum standard? Several hundred meters? If this is not the international standard, I think you should withdraw your plan. In the whole world, all the people are very concerned about air quality. And there are hundreds of thousands of people living in Chuan Kwan Lo, so our health do matter. And the EPD has been implementing this policy, and a lot of problems have been caused. For example, air pollution, and this has a huge impact on our health. We have already expressed our views for a very long time. So how come you have turned a deaf ear to us for so many years? And now you are proposing to extend the Chuan Kwan Lo landfill. Is that your only option? You can't think of any other ways of doing it? You cannot come up with better methods? Can't you find a place which is further away from residential areas to build a landfill? In my hometown, refills is now used to generate electricity. And in Shenzhen, many years ago, they have already been turning waste into energy. So you are incapable, or you are just too lazy to think, or too lazy to work out any new plan. So the government is indifferent to the health of Chuan Kwan Lo residents. Fortunately, there are still councillors that are concerned about our health. They know that we are facing this huge problem. I hope that the government would try to end this problem and close the Chuan Kwan Lo landfill forever. Mr. Chong Wing Hing, I'm also a resident of Lohas Park. I object strongly to the extension of the landfill. This landfill has existed in Chuan Kwan Lo for over 10 years. Many people have mentioned this earlier.
So how come after such a long time, you still want to extend the landfill? Over these years, have you high-ranking government officials really looked into this problem? Have you really thought about relocating the landfill? Because now we have almost 500,000 residents in Chiang Kwan Oh. It's not like 20 years ago, only tens of thousands of people lived there. Now you are sacrificing the health of these hundreds of thousands of people, and you are saying that you have to go on studying and see when the landfill can be closed, and there is no definite timetable. I think that's just an empty promise. So our life's worth nothing? So we should be surrounded by rubbish? You say that? Well, in a few years' time, if the landfills were not extended, then the whole of Hong Kong would be surrounded by rubbish. Well, you should look at our present situation. We are already surrounded by rubbish. You should be well prepared. You should know our pain. And also, the dump trucks cause noise pollution, traffic congestion, and we are living in a dusty environment. And also, methane is generated. We can smell the methane at our homes, not just Lohas Park. Actually, at Hang Hau Po Lam, residents can smell it from time to time. And even the residents of ocean shores can smell it. It all depends on the direction of the wind. Well, you're saying that in the future there will be no food waste in the waste. It's just construction materials. Well, I think you have no conscience. Well, for the construction materials, it will create methane. And after the organic and inorganic compounds would have chemical reactions under the sun and the rain, and they would generate a toxic gas. It's even worse than methane. So what can be done? So you think everybody in Chiang Kwan Oh should be sacrificed? Ms. Ho Ka Po, we are talking about Chiang Kwan Oh landfill and other landfills and their proposed extension. Now, for Hong Kong's landfills, well, they will be saturated soon. Why is that? Because the past terms of governments have never adopted any measure to reduce waste at source. So you are dumping all these MSWs at landfills. Now, it's because the past governments haven't done anything in terms of recycling and waste reduction at source. So that's why we have to solve the problem at the end of the cycle. And in 2005, at that time, we didn't have a bureau for environment. However, there was a proposed MSW management scheme. And now this environment bureau is proposing this action blueprint. I think actually for all these, the most important thing is to implement a producer responsibility scheme and waste charging scheme. Polluters should pay, and financial incentives can encourage people to reduce waste and to recycle waste. Well, just now some of the deputations said that we do not have enough recycling facilities in Hong Kong. Well, in the past, the recycling rate has gone up, but in 2011, the rate dropped. Well, it's because there was less recycling of plastics. Because in Hong Kong, we only have one recycling park handling plastic waste. And in Hong Kong, there is no paper recycling industry. So the government should take all this into consideration. When it comes to recycling, I think it should be done in Hong Kong, so that landfill lives can be lengthened. We are focusing on MSW, but some deputations have also talked about construction materials. That is also very important. I think in the next room, they are talking about reclamation. Well, Hong Kong has to handle a huge amount of construction materials. Although they only account for a small percentage in the landfill waste, however, we are talking about 50,000 tons a day. So why do we have so many construction materials? I think that you should discuss with other bureaus, for example, the development bureaus, and such kind of construction materials should be reduced. I'm a flat owner in Lohas Park, and I was the honorary legal advisor of Capital as well. Well, I urge the government to close Changkwanou landfill immediately. Well, because I think the government is moving the goal all the time. It originally said that it would be closed in 2012 and then 13 and then 15. Now there are 500,000 people living in Changkwanou. We have one university. We have many secondary schools, primary schools, and kindergartens. Many people are living there, and they are suffering from the landfills.
The atmosphere in Hong Kong these days is one such that lies are made out to be the truth. If the administration is not determined to resolve this, I believe that the Bureau will find a lot of difficulties in everything they do. A lot of people have already mentioned about this. Pollution along Wanpo Road, there is no measurement of the odor, and also suspended particulate 2.5 is not dealt with. We don't even have a timetable. You have to tell us. If you say that it's going to close in 2015, what about the extension? We find that completely unacceptable. When we bought the flats, there was no such thing. What we saw from the planning was that year. How come it's now proposed to be extended? If you say that this is an emotional expression of opinion, well, I beg to differ, because, well, before you are judged by the court to be lying, you can't certainly say that you are right. I hope you will have a long-term strategy, a long-term policy to tell us clearly. People were living in Changkwanou, working in Changkwanou, to give us the assurance and to show us that you're actually doing things for us. Miss Ling Oining, I am scared by what I've heard. Last time, there was a non-binding motion endorsed that the administration may take this into consideration, or it may not. And nearly all political parties were helping residents of Changkwanou and Lohas Park in the objection of the extension of the landfill. But I heard that the administration is asking for a bargain about sea transportation, about putting construction waste instead of domestic waste. We don't want any of that. We simply don't want a landfill close to where we live. There is a large amount of people living in Changkwanou. It's impossible for the landfill to be extended. I wasn't there this morning, and last year and the year ago, we have been in loggerheads with the secretary and with Mr. Chan, and I explained to the officials about the inadequacies of this report. I was speaking to Dr. Alan Chan as well. Now we have a different secretary, Mr. Wong Kam Sing and Christine Low and Ms. Michelle Au. And well, we have high expectations of you because you all come from environment green groups. But now you are salaried officials, but you don't think for us anymore. You now ask for the landfill to be extended without doing anything. You have given us an undertaking that it will be closed by a certain number of years, and instead now you tell us that it will be extended. You've given us an undertaking that it will be closed, but you did not deliver. It has never stopped. Have you tried to live right next to a landfill? This morning I did not come because my two daughters, have been sneezing, and their eyes were swollen, and they had to see a doctor. What do you want us to become? Before you became officials, you said that you were from a green group. You are environmental activist. But if you don't understand fully what it's all about, then read the report. Landfill is the lowest form of disposal of waste. And instead of ceasing to use it, you ask to continue to use it for it to be expanded. I don't care where it is as long as it's not near my home. I have been living in Chang Kwan O for 4 years. There has never been a quiet day at home. I always have to go to march, to protest, just to fight for a breath of clean air, which is essential to survival. It's just like when you ask for clean water. If the administration makes people to take to the street, it shows that the administration is incompetent. Shame on the administration. It's a disgrace. There is poor planning, and the administration denies it and continues with the mistake. About two or three decades ago, nobody spoke out when the landfill is in Chang Kwan No, because there was a small population there and there weren't any large residential estates there. But now there are about 400 to 500,000 people living there. And there are a number of projects there as well. Residential development, and at the same time there are many activities at the landfill. We have a string of refuse collection vehicles going there, dump trucks going there, kicking up dust. Our living condition is appalling. It's not just our physical health that is affected, so was our mental state. We're being slowly murdered. They realize that there is a problem. Otherwise, they wouldn't have set up this hotline to receive complaints. And they've talked about many mitigation measures, but they all fail completely. The complaint hotline receive an increasing number of complaints. It's only a waste of taxpayers' money. If the administration is well aware of the fact that the landfill is close to residential area and this is unacceptable, then they should close the landfill as soon as possible and find a suitable alternative or a suitable alternative approach. Of course, it's difficult. If it's not difficult, then high salary officials will not have been asked to do it. And you now have the welfare and lives of tens of thousands of people in your hands. Please put yourself in our place. If you have friends and relatives living near landfill, what would you do? Thank you. Secretary, please reply to the views expressed in this session. Thank you. I'll ask the political assistant and Albert to answer, to supplement and to answer technical questions on technical issues. Mr. Wang Zhenyong talk about a reduction at source, waste charging, and to expand the scope of the producer responsibility scheme and also recovery. These are the key points of our action plan. We will put in a lot more effort to implement them. We work with the Advisory Council on Environment on the details of waste charging. We will shortly roll out the consultation paper on this effective measure that is packed with the production of waste. This involves a change of people's behavior and mentality, and we will expedite it to tackle, to engage in reduction at source. Yes, we step up our effort on reduction at source and collection and recycling, but of course we will have to also deal with the recycling and reuse as well. In the coming 10 years, we have to work with Hong Kong people to create a more conducive culture. And about recycling, this is an interesting point that is food for thought. And when it comes to producer responsibility scheme on glass bottles, this is an institute approach to deal with glass bottles accounting for 1-2% of the waste going to landfill. This is one of the directions. And we see this institute recycling. There are limitations because we have a scarcity of land and it may not be feasible everywhere. Recently, we've been to South Korea, which is bigger than Hong Kong, but still they cannot have a very high rate of in-situ recycle. South Korea is an industrial economy, and there are still only so much they can do, and we face a lot more limitations. Ms. Ang? I've heard from lots of residents, academics, and individuals expressing their views. This is, well, what we see is a macro issue, and residents see it in a more micro way, and it's not a matter of right or wrong. We are responsible, and we try to strike a balance. And the action plan we roll out just now is to tackle in a macro a level how to manage our waste in the coming 10 years. We work on how to implement effective measures, say for example, waste charging and producer responsibility by reducing waste for 40%. What more can we do? And then we will then plan our facilities based on that. And the facilities we have in mind is not, it's just like what Mr. Lam Qiuying said, you can't just simply wave a magic wand to make them disappear. For whatever facilities, it will take at least 8 to 10 years because you will have to go through the statutory procedure, the planning and everything. So while working on reduction at source, we hope to formulate a blueprint to tackle reduction, waste reduction and waste treatment facilities. We would like to address the issues of concern to residents to reduce a nuisance. We hope to eliminate the problem of odor. And we propose for that landfill to receive only construction materials to reduce vehicle trips. And when it comes to pollution, well, we have the clean air plan to tackle Hong Kong's air pollution problem. We have in place $10 billion to phase out old fleet of diesel vehicles. And it's not just about Chong Kwan O, it's territory-wide. waste problem is a problem generated by Hong Kong people, and it has to be tackled by us. Some people mention whether it can be handled by other countries, whether it's international convention or when it comes to justice. This should not be an approach that we need to consider. We have to be tackled here. Dr. Chen, please wait a sec. Members of the public at the public gallery, please do not disrupt the meeting. When it comes to vehicle trips, I'd like to clarify it about the number of vehicle trips. This is a record of the Transport Department. For the four dual carriageways along Wanpo Road, the number of vehicle trips is about 12,000 a day. And out of this 12,000 vehicle trips, about 30% of them are heavy vehicles. And they are lorries, container trucks, or construction site trucks. So it's about 3,000 vehicle trips. The standard of the Transport Department is that the traffic capacity in that role is not yet saturated. That is, there is still room. It's not saturated yet. Some people said that in July 2012, there was a survey showing that during the morning and afternoon peak, the highest flow is 1,700 vehicle trips, which is much lower than the design capacity, which is 2,800 an hour. And I'd like to report to you, a lot of people are concerned about PM2.5, that is fine suspended particulate. Of course, this is a matter of concern to the administration as well. In Wanpo Road alone, Cheung Kwan Road is a developing area. Along Wanpo Road, near Lohas Park, there are 15 construction sites. So when it comes to PM2.5, in August last year, the EPD measured over a 24 period. It's near Dai Chek Sa Fire Station. The PM2.5 level, the average level is per cubic meter 39.5 microgram. The standard is 75 microgram. Of course, we measure over a period of 24 hours. Compared to other areas, I'm not going to list them out all. Central Western District, 44.5. Kwai Chung, 49. Eastern, 32. So you see, in Cheung Kwan Road, the PM2.5 level is similar to other areas. But we've only taken measurement over a day. Starting from July, along Wanpo Road and suitable locations, we will continue to measure the level of PM2.5. And we will disclose the measurement to the public. Thank you. Now I open the floor for members to ask questions. Who would like to ask questions? Mr. Ronnie Tong, 4 minutes. First of all, I thank our guests, especially Cheung Kwan Road residents, for coming to express your views. It's been nine years as a legislator, and I've been following this issue, and I am very disappointed with the stance of the administration. Because whether it is the last term or this term, the secretary is very eager to respond to views expressed by us academics, but he has never responded directly to views expressed by residents. I hope he would do it this time, because that is the minimum requirement of an accountable official. And the second point, I'd like to hear from the secretary about the blueprint of the coming decade. Well, how credible is it? Ms. Preston mentioned about some conflict or contradictions of figures. I won't go to such an academic level. When CY Leung took office, he said that within his term he will not build any incinerators. But now in this blueprint, there is a role played by an incinerator. Is it the case that the secretary ranks higher than CY Leung? Who is lying, you or CY Leung? And a third point. Just now I asked the secretary to give me a direct answer whether he would agree to finish this mission of Chong Kwan Noh landfill eventually. So can you say that for this landfill, do you plan to let it operate forever or what?
Secretary, Madam Chairman, thank you, Mr. Tong. To answer your second question first, if I recall correctly, one of the matters mentioned in the platform of Mr. Leung is that of waste reduction. He said that when necessary, we'll have to consider various options, including waste to energy. I think his position is on the par with what we are saying in our action blueprint. First, we want to waste reduction, but after having reviewed the situation in Hong Kong at this stage, if we do not expand the landfill, we cannot manage. Therefore, we adopt a scientific approach to accord priorities to different options. So, basically, what we're doing now is comparable to what Mr. Leung said. But if Mr. Leung said that he's not going to build any incinerators before he dies, are you saying that this is different? This is not different? What I'm saying is that what Mr. Leung said in his platform is similar to what we are doing now in our action blueprint. The third question, when will the landfill complete its historical mission? I'd like to talk about what I feel about this issue. Now, we are here talking about expansion of three landfills. After listening to the views of the public and today, we'll of course consider your views. Now, you have to bear in mind that there are some topographical limitations. In 2004, we have already considered how to expand the landfills. And what we are proposing now is having full regard to the geographical limitations. For those in the public gallery, it seems to me that the Secretary has not answered my question. He has not said whether he agreed or not that the landfill would be terminated. If it's not going to continue forever, can you give a time frame as to when the landfill will be closed down? Could you give a concrete answer to that? Mr. Tong, to put it simply, even based on our proposal to expand the landfill, we're talking about several years. For those in the public gallery, could you be quiet or else I'll have to ask you to leave? Well, in the paper, we have already set out certain quantities. Just now, I already said, when we talk about the capacity of a landfill, whether when we visited South Korea or Singapore, the government would not say that this landfill would only be used for 5 years and no more, because we have to treasure the landfills. If our policy on waste reduction is effective, then it would extend the period that a landfill can be used. Even in Singapore, for example, their landfill may have a capacity of 14 years, but if their waste reduction policy is effective, then they can expand it to 50 years. I hope you can appreciate that. So the lifespan of a landfill has this matter that you need to take into account for those residents in the public gallery. I'll have to say this again. I have already persuaded you several times and called on you to be quiet. I will have to ask our wardens that if there are people who in the public gallery speak again in the public gallery, then please ask him to leave. Mr. Kwok, this is the first time you speak. I'll allow Mr. Kwok to ask his question first. I think we have already spent about 8 hours now listening to public views. A lot of residents have already spoken from an emotional side or a rational side about opposing the expansion of landfills. I think the Secretary should pay serious consideration to the views of the public. I think people should see clearly that there are a lot of public anger and outcry on this matter. Hong Kong is a small place, but as to the distance between a landfill and a residential development, is there any criteria? When the government granted a piece of land for residential development, even though this may be a problem left by the previous government, this is something that the present government should undertake to resolve. So you can't simply say that this was a problem left by the previous company and you try to wash your hands of it. Just now, the Secretary said that if the landfills can be expanded, if only construction waste are going to be deposited there, then there will be fewer vehicular trips and the dust emission will be lower. What the residents of Chiang Kwan O are concerned is that if the landfill is closed, then there will be no such vehicles, no such trips, no such bad odor. After the expansion of the landfills, there will still be such vehicles. So they are talking about different, looking at the same issue from different angles. And that's why you cannot see eye to eye with each other. I don't know whether that can be recorded. And this looks like it's very difficult to strike a balance. I think you have to appreciate the concern of the Chiang Kwan O residents. Some people even tell you that you don't need to buy a unit there. They will welcome you to stay there. I think only when you can appreciate their concern can you be able to discuss with them in a rational manner. Just now, when you talk about the expansion scheme, you said that only construction waste will be accepted. Is it that construction waste cannot go elsewhere? Is it really necessary for them to be deposited here? If you are saying that there is no other place and there is no other options for domestic waste, then perhaps it is something that we can consider. But you are saying that domestic waste need not go to Chiang Kwan O landfill. Only construction waste will go there. Does it mean that construction waste cannot go to other landfills? I believe that a lot of other landfills can accept these construction waste. So whether it is necessary to go to for these waste to go to the Chiang Kwan O landfills? Yes. On the first question, the sensitive receivers living nearby the landfill, whether there's a minimum distance between the landfill and these sensitive receivers. My understanding is that for these major projects, there's usually an environmental impact assessment, even for Lohas Park. Even though they may not have environmental impact assessment, they must have some sort of environmental assessment. So my colleague will answer this later on. For construction waste, at present, 90% of construction waste have already segregated the inert materials for reclamation use. For the remaining 10%, we're talking about mixed refuse. and they have to be deposited in landfills. And they usually go together with the domestic waste. So for the municipal solid waste and this construction waste, and we would use the existing landfills for the disposal of these domestic waste and municipal solid waste and construction waste. And we understand that one of the concerns of members is older, and therefore we want to strike a balance there. Yes. Concerning environmental impact assessment, in fact, this is quite stringent. When we have this plan to expand the Southeast New Territories landfill, the environmental impact assessments were done very carefully. We look at a lot of targets, for example, health impact, noise impact, air quality, sewage or wastewater. So, while there may not be a requirement of a certain distance between a residential development and a landfill, in fact, we stick to a very stringent requirement. We want to make sure that the neighboring residents, their health will not be affected. In fact, in Chengkwan-O, the environmental impact assessment shows that 43 of these sensitive receivers, Lohas Park is one of them. We have done a lot of surveys such as noise, dust, and gas emission. Some members fear that some organic compounds may have certain gas emission which they did not know, for example, benzene. In fact, in Chengkwan-O and other landfills, since 1994, etc., we have on a regular basis measured the gas emission from these 39 areas or landfills. And their level was lower than the standard. I have also got some data in hand. If you need them, I can tell you. There are 39 types of material or articles. For example, benzene, the target is 16,000. And for the warning level, is 1,600. So that is, we're 100 times more stringent than them. The level that we measured was much lower. In 2012, the survey findings were that in terms of benzene, the level we measured was 1.30 milligram. This is much lower than the 16,000 milligram under the occupational and safety standard. Sorry, it should be 160, not 1,600 that I mentioned just now. So our target is actually much lower than the world level. International level is 16,000, and we set ourselves as 160, so ours is much lower. And we have 39 types of gas, benzene or methane, etc. All these are measured to make sure that your health is protected. Madam Kuo? Thank you. And we have listened to submissions from the public throughout the day. A lot of residents have spoken their minds and expressed their views. I think what we sense most is that they're very concerned, they're very worried. There is nothing more important than the health of our general public. We ask the government time and again how to improve the living environment, how to allay the concern of the residents. Just now, Dr. Chen mentioned a lot of statistics and survey findings, but if you look at the reactions of the residents, is it necessary for you to review these findings? Even though the standards may be met, it seems like the residents still feel that they are deeply affected. Such impact may be dust, even though the level may be lower than international standards. The fact that there are a lot of dusts in the air will already cause discomfort to the residents. And they are also troubled psychologically. They fear that the environment will cause health hazards to them and their family, and this will affect their bodily or physical health. Mr. Tong said that he has followed up on this issue for 9 years. I am new to this chain, electrical, and I'm starting to do this now. But I think a lot of residents have been troubled by this matter for a very long time. I think the government has missed the golden opportunity to address this issue now that the problem is already here. In the last session, you said that you said that construction waste could be included, and you said that there's some legislation that needs to be passed. It seems like there's no immediate measures that can address the concern of the residents. So, under these circumstances, if you talk about expansion of the landfills, how could you expect people to support you? I think what you should do is to try to consider when, how soon you can close the landfills. For those who are not sitting in public gallery, I hope you also behave yourself. Now, if you disrupt the proceedings, then I will have no option but to ask you to leave. Secretary. Now, I have I've been here for several hours already, and I have listened very carefully to the views expressed. I think we are now in a dilemma. On the one hand, for a number of years, we have already had this waste problems. A lot of people supported waste reduction as source, but we have to consider how we handle the waste that have already been generated. We understand the aspirations and concerns of the public. After listening to the views of the those who have spoken, we will listen and will consider their views very carefully. Mr. Kwok, just now, Secretary, in answer to my question, he only said that 10% of these inert materials will have to be mixed up. He has not explained why they have to go to Chen Kuan O landfill. And Dr. Chen said that there were some very stringent requirements about the distance between a landfill and a residential development. Yes, maybe there are some targets, but what happened here is before us, for those residents in the Lohas Park, even though you comply with the standards, the problems are still there, and people find them unacceptable. For the odor and the gas or the dust, etc., they are affecting the residents there. So does it mean that there's something wrong about the standard, or is that in the process the standards have not been complied with? Yes, two questions. On the technical side, I will ask my colleague to answer. Just now, when I answered the question, I was saying that according to the plans of the government, there are three landfills, strategic landfills, one on the east side, one on the north side, one on the west side, so as to deal with the waste accumulated in different parts of Hong Kong. We do so in order to minimize the trips of vehicles carrying these waste. To be more realistic, for example, for Lohas Park, as well as the whole of Chen Kuan O and Kowloon East, there will be a number of residential developments and construction waste will be generated. It is, of course, more convenient to go to the nearby landfill. If Jaguano landfills do not handle construction waste, then for the construction waste that are generated from Lohas Park, they will have to be transported to the other two landfills. This would cause problems to the other landfills. Secretary, the transportation will be handled by the developers. Why do you have to be concerned about that? Well, there are some private developments, but there are also some public housing estates. money is not the only consideration. We have to consider how or what is the most effective way to dispose of these accumulated wastes and at the same time minimize the amount of air pollution caused by the transportation of these wastes. And that was the thinking. And that's why we have three strategic landfills around the territory. Secretary, while you consider, while you mention time and again that there is a balanced approach, of course, if there's no complaint, then you can look at the full picture. But since there are now complaints, I don't think it serves any purpose for you to mention a balanced approach, because a lot of people are saying that the use of the Changguanlou landfill is a wrong decision. Now, of course, we can carry out a study saying that if we continue to use the three landfills to deposit the construction waste, what sort of impact it will have on the road situation, the air quality, etc. This is more objective. For example, if the construction vehicles carry waste to a certain area, it will cause the waste level to exceed our standard, then of course this is more scientific. But according to our preliminary study, in terms of the PM2.5, the level is about the same, and there's no findings to show that the PM2.5 level was on the high side. So that's why I think we have to look at it from a more scientific point of view. Any other officials would like to add anything? Yes, in terms of environmental impact assessment, you said whether the standards have not been complied with. In fact, we pay a lot of attention on environmental audit and monitoring, no matter whether we're talking about organic waste or PM2.5 or surface runoff or underground water. We have a set of very stringent criteria, and at different times we will measure different things. So in the landfills, there are different monitoring points, and at different points of time, we will disclose the findings to the district council as well as members of the public. All these data are evidence that we monitor the situation very carefully. For example, some people are worried that the landfill leakage or gas may affect the environment. We want to make sure that this is not going to be the case. So just now I said that there were 39 matters which are of more concern because they may be carcinogenic, and that's why we measure them. Of course, apart from these 39 matters, there are other things such as surface water, underground water, noise, etc. We also take measurements. So we always use a more stringent standard, and then we will see whether the standard has been exceeded. Thank you, everybody, for attending the hearing today. I'd like to thank residents who sat in since 10 a.m. this morning. A lot of them have sat through the two sessions. Members of the panel have listened very carefully to your views, and in the funding proposal, when we discuss them, members will reflect your views. Thank you. Thank you for attending the meeting today.